Let's as always start with the current development of Starship at Boca Chica. And then what? Elon re-emphasizes the 2022 and 2024 Mars launch windows for Starship. But is that actually doable? And then you might remember that SpaceX wanted to reopen their facility at the port of LA. Well, it's cancelled again. On the other hand, some high-ranking people at NASA and the Space Council are worried that the fundings for the Artemis Moon program won't be enough. Oh, and another Starlink launch, of course. Why not? And of course, we have to talk about the new head of human spaceflight at NASA, Kathy Lueders. Will she be a worthy successor to Doug Lovero? Oh, and Elon gave an interesting update on the Moon Starship.
And believe it or not, the James Webb Telescope has been delayed again. Yes, that's no joke. And a proposal to raise a satellite tax akin to a carbon tax in order to reduce space debris has been put forth. But not enough, because we will also talk about new data from MAVEN about how Mars is losing its atmosphere, the Occupy Mars game for the gamers among you, and a really cool new NASA site called the Solar System Track, which lets you explore many planets and moons in super high resolution. Wow, now that's really a lot to talk about this week, so let's get started right away.
There's always so much happening at Boca Chica. And this week, we can see the Starship SN7 tank prototype being rolled out to the test stand, where it will undergo cryogenic pressure tests. Starship SN7 certainly has an improved design, which allows for even higher pressures, and therefore reduces the probability of future Starship prototypes bursting due to too high pressures. Meanwhile, the canards for the Starship nose cone have arrived and are going to be installed. This nose cone here is going to be attached to SN5. And as it appears, Starship SN5 has now been moved out of the high bay assembly building, while SN6 still waits inside for stacking. It remains to be seen if SN5 will actually perform the hopping tests, and if SN6 will become the first fully assembled Starship prototype with nose cone, flaps, and canards, or if SN5 will already fulfill that role. We think it's more likely that SN5 will only do the hopping tests, and SN6 will then be the first fully assembled Starship since Mark 1. So now first, the cryogenic pressure tests with SN7. And in the next days, we shall see the exact role of SN5 and SN6.
And why suddenly all this progress and parallel development at Boca Chica? Well, because Elon has reaffirmed that the first cargo missions to Mars will still go forth as intended in 2022, with the first human missions to follow in 2024. Something which we, by the way, recently discussed in this video here, where we still thought that these were kind of unrealistic targets. It's as if Elon saw this video and only a few days later said,
"Challenge accepted."
So it seems that now Elon and Gwyn are both totally shifting all their efforts towards getting Starship off the ground ASAP. Gwyn even went as far as to say in a podcast that if Starship won't land on Mars in the next years, it would be a huge failure for SpaceX as a company. Whew, that's the spirit. It really seems as if we might have to readjust our timeline and make it a bit more optimistic. Even though 2022 and 2024 seem crazy ambitious, who knows, a lot can happen in this time. And we still hope that Starship will be tested on the Moon first, or at least do Moon and Mars simultaneously. That would actually be our preferred future scenario. We will, by the way, analyze this possibility in a separate video. In any case, the news that SpaceX will now shift all its resources and its focus towards the development of Starship is excellent news.
In other news, SpaceX cancelled their plans to build a new Starship construction facility at the port of LA. Again. You might remember that the first ever Starship tank prototype that was constructed, back then still with carbon fiber composites instead of steel, happened in late 2017 at the port of LA. Then in early 2018, the port was abandoned and the prototype destroyed. Because SpaceX moved Starship development to Boca Chica, Texas, and Cocoa, Florida. After the Cocoa site was put on hold, all Starship building activities shifted to Boca Chica. Then we had news in February this year that SpaceX would lease land at the port of LA to build a new Starship facility. But now this seems to be cancelled again. We suspect that it has something to do with Elon's recent feud with the Californian authorities, who didn't allow the Fremont factory to reopen. Elon was very angry, and he said that he would move Tesla headquarters away from Cali. It seems that this now also affects the plans of building a new Starship facility at the port of LA. Well, what can we say? Cali has angered Elon, and Elon reacted. Maybe next time, Californian politicians shouldn't drop F-bombs on Elon, you know. Then we have another Falcon 9 Starlink launch. Those Starlink satellites now really go up like a conveyor belt. No, like a machine gun. The number of working Starlink satellites now stands at 535. At this rate, we will top 1,000 still this year. Crazy but true. Then, the Executive Secretary of the National Space Council, Scott Pace, and Kevin Bowersox, Acting Associate Administrator of NASA's Human Exploration and Mission Operations Directorate. These NASA titles every time. Both think that the current funding for the Artemis Moon program won't be enough, even with the 12% increase for 2021. They both spoke to a joint meeting of the Space Studies Board and Aeronautics and Space Engineering Board of the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering and Medicine. Both Pace and Bowersox think that pulling the moon landing goal from 2028 to 2024 is beneficial. But Bowersox said that Congress still doesn't believe getting to the moon by 2024 is a good idea. And he said that it will take a lot to convince Congress and to secure the funds which NASA needs to make it happen. Let's hope that they can convince Congress to increase NASA's budget by even more than 12%. Because NASA's budget request asks for up to $28 billion annually by 2024.
And maybe the new chief of human spaceflight, Kathy Lueders, or Lueders, who knows, can help with that. She now takes over Doc Lovero's role a few weeks after he stepped down and left NASA, due to possible reasons which we discussed in this video here. Lueders, I will just call her Lueders, previously was the director of NASA's Commercial Crew Program, so she had the oversight of the SpaceX Crew Dragon Demo 2 mission. This could prove to be really beneficial, since she knows firsthand that working together with SpaceX delivers very good results, as has been impressively shown with Demo 2. She therefore certainly has an open mindset towards SpaceX, something which will certainly be needed in order to achieve the goal of landing humans on the moon by 2024. Let's just hope that she has a strong psychology and a lot of willpower, because she will certainly need it in that position. We certainly wish her best of luck in this new position.
But while still on the topic of the moon, Elon tweeted something highly interesting last week in a tweet exchange with the everyday astronaut. Sure, the new landing legs are interesting, but we found it more interesting that the early starships will stay on the moon and will become part of the moon base. Aha! Now that is really something. Because this had been our suggestion in this video here. But we suggested landing the starships horizontally and cover them with lunar regolith for better cosmic ray protection. We would still suggest tilting them after they landed, because standing there like that, they would be bombarded with cosmic rays. This makes a lot of sense, as this would be the easiest and also most cost-effective way to build a moon base. The starships are essentially giant habitats, and the fuel tanks would not be needed, so they too could become living space. One starship could thus offer thousands of cubic meters of interior living space. This way, we could have a giant moon base in 4 to 5 years, It sounds insane, but it's doable.
But now bad news. The James Webb Space Telescope, which had already been delayed a felt thousand times, now has been delayed again. Yes, this is unfortunately not a joke.
What? Huh? Just that delay? Again? Hush, not James Webb!
This was a joke. It was a joke. It's not delayed. It's not delayed.
Okay.
It was only a joke.
That was close.
It was only a joke. It was not a joke. And who do we blame this time? Of course, the pandemic. So the new launch date is now July 2021 instead of March 2021. Yeah, sure, the pandemic caused a delay of 4 months. Right. We need to get James W. Space Telescope into space ASAP because it will be the first instrument allowing us to scan exoplanet atmospheres with such a precision that we could detect biosignature gases and even technosignature gases, for example FCKW molecules, that can only be created artificially by technological alien civilizations.
We really need this space telescope, because it will help us find alien life. And this is a very noble goal, we'd say. And it will be one of the most important and greatest discoveries in all of human history. So come on, guys. Please stop delaying the James Webb. Then we have a new proposal for solving the space debris problem in a paper by Aki Rao from the University of Boulder, Colorado, and his colleagues. They suggest implementing an orbital use fee for new satellites. This fee would be calculated based on the collision probability a new satellite would cause with the other ones. So this idea is very similar to the carbon tax. The orbital use fee for satellites would in theory incentivize launching less unnecessary satellites, so that over time, more space debris would fall back to Earth than new debris created, thus significantly reducing the space debris problem. The fees would rise by 14% per year, up to $235,000 per satellite by 2040. Counterintuitively, this would also raise the value of the space industry in low Earth orbit. So it's a highly interesting non-engineering approach to solve the space debris problem. Then NASA has released a new video detailing how Mars is losing its atmosphere due to solar wind. So this evil solar wind is constantly stripping Mars of its atmosphere, which is the reason why Mars has such a thin atmosphere nowadays. And the atmosphere of Mars was much thicker in the past. And no, this is not a deal breaker to terraforming. This problem can be solved in multiple ways. And if you are interested, we will of course talk about it in a special Mars terraforming video.
Then for the gamers among you, we tried out the Occupy Mars game demo on Steam for PC, and it's quite fun despite some major shortcomings regarding controls. We especially liked the cool Western soundtrack, which somehow creates this Western Mars desert kind of feeling. The game is still in the alpha phase, so it's far from finished, but should the developer Pyramid Games get these issues fixed until release, the game could really prove to be a must-play for every fan of Mars colonization when it comes out later this year. And another cool piece of software is the Solar System Track by NASA. You can explore the surface of most solar system bodies in super high resolution, but of course, we want to explore Mars most of all, right? Jixuan and me played around with the program a bit. It's a complete in-browser application, and the amount of detail is just stunning. You can, for example, explore the future Erebus Montes landing site, the favorite site for humanity's first Mars base, and maybe even find some possible suitable sites for the SpaceX base camp yourself. This site here, for example, would not be so perfect, because as we can see, landslides are really a potential risk factor on Mars and have to be taken seriously. You can also follow the path of the Curiosity rover if you want, and much more. It's also a must for every Mars fan. One could even go as far as to say it's a musk for every Mars fan. Okay, that one really didn't have to be. So do you think Kathy Lueders or Lueders will be a worthy successor to our beloved Doug Lovero as the new chief of human spaceflight?
And do you think that it's doable for Elon to launch Starship to Mars already in 2022 or 2024?
It would be nice, it would be awesome.
And if you want to know our opinion on that, you can check out this video right here.
So then, thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, see you next time and on to the future. That was fun. Not a joke.
Good. Hawk likes it.